director or the casting director. I mean, as you actors know, the casting director is absolutely critical. Thank you, Dan. So, I'm going to revert to the writing side of me. I've only directed one film in my life, and this film, if it happens, will be my second, so I'm not very experienced. So, I think the most useful thing I can tell you is how my career happened, and I'm not going to attempt to tell you how to write, because you could probably all write a great deal better than me, to be honest. I mean, the standard of writing out there is extremely low. So that is not your problem, I would guess. If any of you were stuck at it, you're probably perfectly okay as far as the writing goes. The problem is how you get people to take you seriously as a writer. That is an immense problem, because all of the gatekeepers, whether it's an agent, or in film terms, a producer, I write plays and I write books as well. So you know, each of these have their gatekeepers. And on the whole, they are going to think when they receive material from an unknown that it's not worth their attention. They'll give it to an intern, and it's very difficult to get through. Whereas if you already have a name, as I have, any old crap gets acted, which is not very encouraging for everybody else. But it is the truth. And when you sometimes say to yourself, when you think what blood and tears you put into your own work, and you look at something on television, or on the film, or on the stage, and you think, how did this junk get here? That's the answer. Somebody like me, who they already know about, and they think he'll be a safe pair of hands, and actually I've written junk. But by then they've paid for it. I try not to write junk. And I should tell you that I would say 50% of everything I do is never produced. So it's difficult and whatever. I'm what is called in Hollywood terms an A-list writer, which means that I make a lot of money. But it also does not mean that my work is produced. I could be sacked and have been, and other people take over my work. So it never gets to a place where you're safe. But that's our business, you all know that. I mean, most people do another job in order to keep things going. So I'll tell you how it worked for me, and I'm not claiming that I did it through raw talent, because I've worked with a lot of young writers, so I think they're much more talented, to be honest, and I have a real difficulty getting through. You have to do something that gets noticed. There's a sort of turning point in every career. And to get there, you've really got to keep on trying, putting the stuff out there. Now, if we talk about film scripts, I started out as a wannabe novelist. I didn't want to be a film writer. I didn't think of it. It wasn't that I was against it. I didn't think of it. I wanted to be a novelist. And I still am a novelist, by the way. I write novels. But not that anybody reads them, but I do write them. They do get published. And I was blasting away at my novels early every morning. I had a day job, and I got up early, as I still do, and get up about 4:45 every morning, and I just got the habit, and I do a lot of work in the mornings. In those days, I would work till 10, then I would go into my day job, which was at the BBC, where I was a documentary filmmaker. And I wrote a lot of novels, and they were not good, and they were not published, and that was very hard for me. But, you know, here I am age 69, looking back on those early days. I wouldn't have it any other way, to be honest, because I truly think I got better. And I do think about writing. It's not unlike, I don't know, building a wall. You know, when you start out, you don't build a good wall, but if you've done it enough, you start to get the bricks straight. And I think you do need to do a lot. And you need to do a lot, and you need to get a lot of feedback, and you need to respond to that feedback. And that's very hard. When I was first writing my novels, I was quite convinced that what I was writing was incredibly good. But I was also very careful not to show it, because they might not share my view. So I hoarded my work, and it took about 2 years to write a book, because I was doing another job as well. And then I would send it. I did have an agent at that point, university, the agents had come sort of trawling, looking for talent, and I'd done a certain amount of writing at university for the newspaper. That was all, nothing grander than that, for the university newspaper. So I did have an agent, and each time I produced my novel, my agent would say, "I'm sorry, it isn't any good." And that was devastating, and so I had to go into a sort of state of what's wrong, what have I done wrong, why doesn't it work? Because you know when you write, there's a version of what you write in your head that's incredibly vital, powerful, and that's not what anybody reads. They read something that they bring to it what they have. With your own writing, you bring to it what you have, which of course is all part of the writing, and half of what you bring to it isn't even on the page. So you're not even aware how limited it is. And you only discover that when somebody else reads it and says things like, "Why did she fall in love with him?" And you say, well, him's me. And, you know, obviously. And they say, "Well, I don't get it. I would have done that. I would have fallen in love with him. He's boring. He's obsessed. You know, why would anybody fall in love with him?" And it's very difficult to detach yourself, which is why criticism or critical response is terribly important, but it's also terribly important who you go to for that criticism. I would say don't go to people close to you if possible. It's hard for them, very hard. To your loved ones, to your friends, what are they going to say? You know, what they're actually thinking is, well, it's got something that it doesn't really work, you know, and they don't know how to say that. So you need to go to somebody who's a little bit outside. The very best person is somebody who has a vested interest in the success of the work. A publisher, an editor, a director, a producer, an agent, all these people professionally want to see your work good. And they're not going to tell you it's good or it isn't. And these are really valuable. Doesn't mean they're right. It really doesn't. And we all know the endless stories of people who've been rejected by 17 publishers or film scripts that have been rejected 20 times and then they're made and they're a work of genius. So, it's not for sure. All I can tell you is for me, my work when I started out was too interior, was too much in my head, it was too much. I was double guessing what the reader would think and trying to be clever all the time. And I think that's one of the problems actually of early writing is the problem of, it's really showing off. It's cleverness, trying to be clever. And at the end of the day, nobody really cares. What they care about is story and character. And you can tell when you pick up a piece of work, it has a character that engages you, or it has a story that draws you in. You can have a story with very poor characters, obviously, caricatures. But if the story is strong, and most thrillers are like this, if the story is strong from the beginning, that's going to work. So I think outside criticism is vital. I had outside criticism to the extent that my novels failed regularly. I mean, don't even mean failed, they didn't get published. And so I got to a point where I was quite despairing. And this is the interesting thing. If you love writing, you want to be a writer, how do you keep going? How do you keep going with endless disappointment? I think the answer is it's impossible. You need a little bit. You need something to tell you you're not mad. That you're not just deluding yourself that you're any good. And you've probably already had a little bit of this, a little bit of that, where you think, yes, that's worked. Some of you may be hugely successful, I don't know, obviously. I had one radio thing. A work of mine. Suddenly, there were actors, they were speaking it. And on Radio 4. And the chap who was then taking radio scripts, General Bill Ash, said to me, "I love this. Give me more." So I thought, yes! I wrote six more, very fast. And he rejected all six. I'm sorry, it's no good. And then there was another time when I entered a competition. There was a Spectator, actually, and it was a kind of competition where you had to write like a documentary piece about something real that was happening. Quite long, about 5,000 words. And you had to submit it under a pseudonym so that anybody could enter and it would protect the unknown people from the known people. And I won it. And that kept me going. You know, I lived on that for about 4 years in psychologically. So then, there I am banging away at my novels, and my friends in the BBC knew I was doing this. So one day, one of my friends said, I want to make a I was in a documentary, I'll tell you where I was. I was in the religious television department at the BBC, making religious television documentaries. It was a series which was long gone called Everyman. And it was sort of ethical, some of them straight religion, but a lot of them more spiritual, whatever. And which I absolutely loved. I loved doing this. And I had a very good friend called David Thompson, who was like me doing exactly the same thing as me, and another good friend called Norman Sternberg. So we were three documentary filmmakers. Norman wanted to be a drama director. David wanted to be a drama producer. David ended up running BBC Films, and he's now got his own company with Origin Pictures. But back then, David said to me, Norman's got an idea. It was the Martin Luther anniversary. In fact, there's another one just come around.
Yes.
So this must have been his birth or his death or whatever. Anyway. And he said, we think we can get some money from the Lutherans in America. And we can use the BBC Wales facilities, which in those days were very underused, because the Welsh language, they had to have all these facilities. They didn't have any cash to make any programs. So and David was very clever at this, working in the inner workings of the BBC. So he found a studio, he found a camera crew, he found makeup, he found costume. What they needed was a script, and they had no cash of any kind, there was no question of paying. But David said, you know, you're always writing, aren't you, apparently? And I said, yeah, yeah. Well, would you write us a script about Martin Luther? So I thought, I don't know anything about Martin Luther, but I suppose I can. So I did, and the interesting thing about this was, all my novels had been about, you know, the intense experience of being 25 and your girlfriend leaving and all that kind of stuff. This wasn't about me. This was about a monk in the 16th century or whatever it was. And I had to research. I had to do research. So I had to use material that was really there and use my capacity to construct a story, which I'd been honing, making medical documentary films. So I wrote this script, and it was really about Martin Luther as a political animal. It was only an hour long. And David sent it to Jonathan Pryce. And Jonathan Pryce said, oh, that looks nice. I'll do that. And so they did it. And this little film got made, television film, and there was my name on it, written by it. And we had an absolute blast doing this. Now, you couldn't do this in the BBC today. However, I'm sure you could do it elsewhere. I'm sure you could do equivalent things, particularly on the internet, of course, where everything costs nothing. So that was my particular. So we did this. I wouldn't say it was any great shakes, but it happened and it looked real, and Norman the director did a fabulous job, and Jonathan Pryce did a fabulous job. And my work, nobody seemed to say who is this rank amateur, they just accepted. So then Norman, David and I looked at each other and said, let's do this again. We were doing it on the side, our main job. And Norman had a project to do with C.S. Lewis. And I didn't really know anything about C.S. Lewis, and I didn't really like C.S. Lewis. I was raised as a Roman Catholic, and if you're a Roman Catholic, C.S. Lewis is very sort of Protestant in his theology. You don't really take him seriously. And my mother used to call him a drippy protty. She thought it was all rubbish, and the Narnia books were just rubbish. So we didn't have him as a child. I hadn't read the Narnia. And all I knew about C.S. Lewis was he was this sort of basically fake religious person. Real religious people, of course, were Catholics. So Norman said, why don't we do this thing about C.S. Lewis? I said, no, I don't know. What is that? And I went off making my documentaries, and they struggled and they struggled, and they couldn't put a script together. So David came back to me and said, look, just take a look at the story. It's a real life story. It might interest you. So I looked at it, and it was actually the story of this 50-whatever-year-old guy who'd never married and was very, very screwed up and very emotionally locked up, ending up having a love affair with an American Jewish divorcee who was a fag. And this love affair sort of opened him up, blew him up. And I realized that this was a sort of weird parallel to what was happening in my life. which was that I was by then, and we were talking now, I was 32, 33, something like that. I was finding it very difficult to commit to any relationship. I was absolutely not married. I told myself it was because I wanted to be a writer, and writers don't have a pram in the hall, you know, you've got to be free. But that was not true. I didn't know that. I was frightened of, as many young men are, and I was going to say young even, frightened of commitment. Frightened of commitment. Why? Because when you commit, you put yourself in a position where you can be hurt a lot. You can be left. And of course, with C.S. Lewis, that had happened to him with his mother. His mother died when he was 10. He was profoundly wounded by this. Wasn't going to give his love again. And there was me. My mother hadn't died, but big problems in my parents' marriage, and I guess that all flowed through. And so I was very, very nervous of commitment. And I didn't realize it, but I wrote it as if it was me. And I think this is quite a good kind of little clue to, I mean, it's obvious actually. If you're going to write anything that's any good, it's going to have powerful emotions. Whose emotions are they? So you have to find material that channels something you care a lot about. You may not realize you're doing this, but when you say, I like that story, I'm going to write that story, that's actually what's happening. You're finding something that happens in you that can tell you about. So I told the story of C.S. Lewis and how he was frightened of commitment, became very close to Joy, backed away from her, suddenly she gets cancer, she's dying, he suddenly realizes he doesn't want to lose her, opens up, out floods all the emotions he's been holding back for so long. They have a brief, 3 years together, because she has a remission in cancer. And he's incredibly happy, and then she dies, and he's incredibly hurt, just like he knew he was going to be. And the kind of message of the whole thing is, you can't get the one without the other. If you want the joy, you have to take the pain. And so I wrote this, and as I say, it was sort of a metaphor in a way for what I wanted, but hadn't got myself. And it worked. The script worked. David got Joss Ackland and Claire Bloom to do the art, and it was made as a TV film. And it won the BAFTA Award for that year. So suddenly, I was real. That's right. Just like that. And everybody needs something like that to, and suddenly I was being offered real work with actually painting money. And the next thing I wrote, which was called Life Story, which was about DNA, Crichton Watson, also won the BAFTA Award in its year. And then the next thing I wrote, called Sweet As You Are, with Liam Neeson and Miranda Richardson, was also very successful. So suddenly, I had gone from nowhere to being a television writer who was taken seriously. And of course, everything is different from that moment on. From that moment on, what you start saying to yourself is, okay, the door is open now. What am I going to do with this? My script of Shadowlands, we turned into a stage play, and that won the Evening Standard Best Play of the Year. Then went to Broadway, and it got Tony Awards. And then it became a movie, and I was nominated for an Oscar. All on one project. So I thought, well, this is easy. You write a script, and the next thing you're at the Oscars. Of course, it never happens. The script that Richard Attenborough filmed was exactly what I wrote. It's never happened since. Everything I've written since has been screwed around one way or another. Sometimes for the better, mostly for the worse. But I had a career. Now is the question, what do you do with your career? And I think I made a mistake. I think I got a bit carried away, and suddenly I was getting a lot of offers from Hollywood, and I didn't know enough about the system to realize that just because they ask you to write a film, and just because they pay you to write the film, it doesn't mean they make the film. And so, as I say, a large number of scripts are sitting on the shelves of the studios by me, some of which I think are quite good, never going anywhere. And that's a kind of waste, you know, because that was in my 40s, very important time in your creative life. And if I were to do it again, or if any of you get to this position, or if you're in this position, I would say, don't be seduced by that. Stick with, I should have stayed in London, I should have done London work with London people or British people, much less money. But it would have, more would have got made, and I think it would have been creatively better for me. But I was overexcited by the, you know, you get first-class flights to and from Los Angeles, you get these enormous, not anymore by the way, it's changed, enormous sums of money. I mean, the enormous sums of money are good because I've now got a pension. So when I stopped earning all the Hollywood money, which I have done, I've got a pension, so I'm fine. And that's really important. But I think it was a mistake, creatively. And little by little, I realized this, that I was being hammered by the screenwriting process, which is absolutely brutal. I don't know if anybody here has experienced the American-style screenwriting process. It's very, very heavy duty. They take the view, and it's fair enough. We're paying you. If you don't deliver, we're going to tell you. If it's not what we want, we're going to tell you. And if you go on failing, we're going to sack you. And they don't sort of think about the bit where you say this is good, you know. You just think about the bit of saying, okay, fine, that didn't work. Why are you doing that? Here we've had a brilliant idea, why don't you do this? And I'm saying that brilliant idea doesn't fit this script at all. And I've had meetings, I mean, I wrote a script that I thought was wonderful called Rainbow Bridge, and for DreamWorks. And I get a phone call saying, Stephen loves it. So I think this is nice. You know, this is Spielberg who owns the studio. So I go over and there's Stephen and meet him. He says, this is wonderful. I'm going to do it myself. I'm going to direct it myself. And I've had this terrific idea for this scene. He then outlined the scene, which makes absolutely no sense. It's a good scene. It makes no sense. So I scratch my head and say, well, yeah, interesting, you know. And then he goes off, and I say to the others, what am I going to do? This is stupid. And they say, well, it's Stephen, you know, you better do it. So I do it, and of course it doesn't make any sense. And anyway, he loses interest, and he goes off to another project, which is what he does all the time. And the whole thing is completely futile. And you think, why am I doing these stupid things? And so slowly, I realized I would have to shift gear. And I thought, I'll go back to writing. And I thought, what went wrong when I was writing books before? And I answered myself that I was, as I said earlier, I was trying to be too clever. How can I stop myself from showing off in the writing? And I thought, I know what, I'll write for kids. I had three children by then, having overcome the commitment shortly after becoming a full-time writer, which I did at the age of 37. I was 37 when I abandoned my day job. And I was 39 when I proposed. And I, no, 39 when I got married. And was I 40? Anyway, late. But anyway, enough time, and there's suddenly three children have appeared. And there I am thinking, I'll write for kids. And by now my children were aged like 12, 10, and 8. And I thought the great thing about this is, you know, you can't do subtext and textual analysis and so on. You just tell stories. So I wrote a book called The Wind Singer. And I just loved this. And all I thought when I was writing it is, it's gotta be fun, it's gotta be fun, it's gotta be fun. They've gotta want to read every page. That's all I have to do, make them turn the page. And it really, really worked. Now, the interesting question, it was published and it was very successful. It got a couple of awards and it's still very much in print. It's just come out in a classic version. It's been in most schools. And I believe it sold, I mean, it's not selling like Harry Potter, but I think it sold something like 600,000 to date. So, you know, serious stuff. And why did that work and my other novels didn't? And I think it was because I learned a lot through the bashing I got in Hollywood, where they're constantly saying, you know, where's the hook? Why do we want to go into Act Two? Where's the denouement and so on? And I think I learned a bit of story structure. And the thing about story structure, it's incredibly obvious, you probably all know it, but you have to begin with something that makes people want to go on, obviously. That's the hook. So within, I don't know, how many minutes or how many pages, not too many. It's okay, you can swim around creating atmosphere, but something's got to happen, or some question has got to arise that makes people go, oh, I want to watch this, or I want to read this. That's obvious. Second, you must have a protagonist that the reader or the viewer cares about. Now, that doesn't mean they have to be good. They can be villains that you've got to care about. I mean, Breaking Bad is an obvious example of a man who is pretty obnoxious, but you kind of care because of the situation they put him in and because of his antagonist. So and I think the third thing is you've got to have an enemy. And a lot of people, I think, fail on that one. A lot of contemporary work, a lot of TV series I see, they set up fantastic plot, but you're really mystified and fascinated, and they don't actually know how to end it. When you get to the final episode, you think, what? All the guys were wearing balaclavas, and apparently they're all men. What's going on? And it's, it really offends me. You need, in my opinion, to know your ending before you start.
Yeah.
You need to know where you're going, because then you can plot it out well. And what is it you're plotting? You're plotting an emotional journey. That's really what writing is, I think. It's an emotional journey. And what is the emotion? What's going to be the resolution of the emotion? Now, I'm talking about a storytelling type writing. There may be, you know, those among you who write a different kind of work, which is really about your own voice. And that's different. If you write from your own voice in a way that's magical and spellbinding, then everything I say doesn't apply. Hmm. But you better have a very interesting voice.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, feed your reader or your viewer the food that they crave, which is a beautifully structured story about characters who they're very engaged by. With my Windsinger, the theme of it was a world built on examinations, where everybody was examined, including parents and everybody, once a year, and a family who rebelled against the examination system. And I did it because I was so angry at the examination system at the time, what it was doing to my children.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a genuine anger, and I made my villains were the examiners, and they were an elite cast. It was a fantasy book. And it was a very structured world that treated people who were considered to be stupid very badly. And this is one of the reasons why I think a lot of kids responded so strongly to it, because it was basically an assault on the whole testing regime. Unsurprisingly, it is a set book in many schools. but it worked. So then I thought, okay, I'm going to start doing stuff in this country much, much more. And that's what I've been doing ever since. I've done a lot of work with Working Title. But I've also been writing adult novels of the kind that I failed to do before. And I can't claim any grand success for them, but I do love them. And I finally got to a point where I thought I'm experienced enough to write about my own world. And so I live near Lewis and in a village. And it's the lives of people like me in this village, so it's not, in a sense, very sort of suitable for social purposes, but it's what I know. And I've written a whole series of novels. The first one was called The Secret Intensity of Everyday Life. And it's my attempt to get inside how people are feeling now, because I think novels do this in a way that nothing else can do. I mean, we all know our own weaknesses and our own fears. We see other people in a different way. We see other people's front. And the front we all put up is that we're doing okay. And it's actually not true. And we know it of ourselves. We know that we're struggling. We know that we suffer from tremendous self-doubt. Sometimes very extremely. I mean, a lot of people are very, very depressive and are struggling with that. A lot of people have problems with alcohol. A lot of people have really, really dysfunctional families and marriages and relations with their children. But they struggle on. We all struggle on. And we all think we are the one who is not really doing all that well. And all these other people seem to be fine. Now, you go into a novel, and you can go into each person in a group of people and show how they're all misreading each other because of this assumption we have. And I think novels can do that brilliantly, particularly when it comes to love and sex, which is the stuff I write about mostly. And I think that we don't communicate very well with each other in this area. There's a sort of romantic version, which is fine, which is fun storytelling that isn't what happens to our real life. And then there's the pornography version, which is, you know, fine for a bit of fun, but is also completely untrue and not what happens in real life. So what actually does happen? How are all our friends and people around us and neighbours, how are their lives functioning? What do they do? Do they have masses of sex and I'm the only one who's not? Or, you know, is the fact that I managed to have sex 3 months ago mean I'm ahead of the game? You just don't know. And what do they do when they do it? And how do they cope with their failures and so on? Well, you can say all that in novels, and I do. So my novels, there's a lot of, I wouldn't say explicit, but open talk. But it's talk about it, it's writing about what I think really happens in our lives, which is a bit of a muddle, and also the reasons we carry on with people are so complicated, and the things we want out of people are so complicated, that actually it's quite a victory if you maintain a marriage or maintain a group of friends, because we are pretty lonely, most of us. We are pretty alone, and you know, they say you're born alone and you die alone, and I think that's true. And how do we connect? And when I wrote the screen version of Shadowlands, I wrote a line which I gave to Jack Lewis, to C.S. Lewis. He has a student who I invented, who he's getting books in the bookshop, and this student is actually stealing books. And Lewis sees him doing it, and the student gets very kind of defensive, and he says, what's the point of them? These books? What's the point? Who cares? I don't want them. Just take them. He's a working class kid, and he says, I do not see the point. When it all comes down to everything we're doing, you, a professor of literature, the books, what, who cares? And Lewis says, as written by me, not by Lewis, we read to know we're not alone. And that has been the sort of core of my belief before I wrote this and after. And it's very annoying to find on the internet people quoting C.S. Lewis saying this. And then they get on to me and they say, we can't track. we read to know we're not alone. I think it's really true. I think novels can do something very, very profound about the gaps between us and the way we fall into those gaps. Much, much more profound than television or films. And it's what I really love. Just a new novel of mine has just come out called Adventures in Modern Marriage. And that's the seventh since I resumed being a contemporary novelist. But you should know that I could not make a living out of these novels. They're all published. They all get very well reviewed. I don't know what they sell because I don't ask. I don't ask because I know the number would not be big enough to satisfy me. I do know that they go on publishing these, so presumably they're just breaking even. Nothing more than that. I'm certainly not known as a novelist. But I love it. And I think if you want to be a writer, in a sense, you've got to not expect to make a living at it. I have made a living because of the film work at a price. I think you have to have another source of income, or a friendly spouse or something like that. And you've got to write because you love it. And it is an extraordinary thing to do, writing, quite extraordinary. The days when I went around schools talking to kids, I would say, I don't want any of you to be writers, because we writers actually rule the world. And we need lots of slaves to suck up what we do. And so you stay down there being slaves, and we writers rule the world. And how do we rule the world? We rule the world by creating the narratives by which you will live. And that may be through a novel that only two people read, or it might be through a commercial which a billion people watch and are influenced by. But essentially, writers, story makers, are creating the narratives by which people live. And alas, look at what's happened to the democratic process because of this. You know, when you get malign actors moving in on this and fake news, that's, we're creating narratives, that's all that is. So I say that to them. I say, don't be a writer. However, I do say, should you find yourself compelled, you will get an enormous benefit from it, which is nothing to do with any success you have, which is that you will live twice as long as everybody else. You'll do this because you will live each moment of your life twice. You live it as you live it, and you live it as you digest and write about it, which is what you do. Every time you write all day, you're really reliving your moments of your life. So you are actually somebody who is living twice when everybody else only gets to live once. And that's a massive reward. I think it makes writers compassionate and wise beyond the way they would otherwise be. It forces you into an empathetic position. In other words, you're thinking, what does it feel like to be other people? And you have to do that all the time as a writer, and you do research. I write a lot of parts in films for women, and in my books a lot of them. And I'm not a woman, so how do I know? The answer is I do an awful lot of asking and learning. And there's a chapter in my novel, Secret Intensity of Everyday Life, which those who've read it comment on a lot, and it's about shopping. And I was determined to write about the psychodrama of clothes shopping for a woman. And so I did a very intensive bit of research on this, and I wrote a chapter about a character who, she wants to buy a new dress because somebody's invited her to buy it. And she's a very busy woman, and she's got a short period, she goes up to London, and she's got 3 hours to buy this thing. And she goes through several shops, and she ends up and buys something. And I realized this is not as simple as it seems. This is not just, oh, do I like that or don't I like that? It's an intensely emotional process, because it's all about yourself and your image of yourself. And it's also about your fear that you'll not be able to find something suitable. And what happens to her is she goes into the first shop, and she sees something, and she thinks, yeah, I kind of like that. And she tries it on, and yeah, it's all right. And the sales assistant says, shall I put it aside for you? And she says, no, I really just started. And as she goes out to the shop, she thinks, you know, they can't fool me with that one. That's a sort of sales gimmick to try and make me buy. Because she, you know, the sales assistant said, it's the only one we've got. No. So she goes, and gradually she goes further and further. It looms larger and larger. And she saw it first, and that didn't give it enough status. And she suddenly realizes, actually it's the best. And I'm going to lose it. Because it's the only one. And even now somebody's in there buying it. And so she turns and she runs all the way back. And it's there, and she buys it. But there's a lot of detail in this chapter about what's going through her head. Now that's all research. I don't shop like that at all. You know, I shop like a man shops. Is it my size? I don't know, I'll take it. and a lot of people say, how did you know? Well, it ain't hard. You ask. You know, you get a couple of, you know, my wife and some girlfriends and say, right, let's go shopping. What are you doing? You've made up, tell me. And you know, and she tells me, you start off, you think of the clothes you're going to put on, comfortable shoes you're going to run walking, clothes you can slip off quickly, decent underwear because the sales assistant's going to see you in your knickers. And you put all this in. And you think, huh? So, but I think it's the only time anybody has ever taken shopping seriously. So that's what I'm doing these days, and I'm absolutely loving it. My latest film work will come out in October, and it's called Breathe, and the actors are Andrew Garfield, you may have come across him recently, he was in Hacksaw Ridge and also in The Silence, he was Spider-Man a long time ago, and Claire Foy, have any of you seen The Crown? She's the queen in The Crown. It's worth seeing. I don't want you to have to pay Netflix, but it's very good, and Claire Foy is stunning. But in my film, I didn't direct it, I wrote it. She's unbelievably good. And that opens October 27th. And Tom Hollander and Hugh Bonneville and Stephen Lang and various other people. So I'm excited about that because it's a film that's actually appeared. And I'm working on the film I hope to make next year, which will be shot by me, which is called Hope Gap, and will be shot in Seaford. Which is actually about the collapse of my parents' marriage at a late stage. It's about two people in their early 60s breaking up and the tremendous pain that produces and for the grown-up son. And with a bit of luck, that'll get shot next summer. We have the money, we just need the cast, but it won't be out until the year after that. I'm also doing a Black Township musical in Cape Town, as well as that. Because I did a film about Nelson Mandela. So that's what I'm up to. And I think I'm going to be able to go on for a few more years, I don't know how many, until the brain conks out. But I think the good news for me is that it gets better as you get older, unlike most jobs. It gets better in the sense that you relax more, you learn more, you're wiser, your technique is better, and you're not as competitive and ambitious. And ambition and competition, which, if you don't do very well, simply takes the form of envy, is corrosive. And you don't need that. What you need is to think, I've got something in me that's special to me, and if it finds an outlet somewhere, great. But I'm living my life. It's happening now. It's not going to happen then when I succeed. And I think that wasn't there, was it, when I was young? The provisional life. This isn't it. My life hasn't started yet. My life will start when I'm a successful writer. That was the way I was living. Stupid. Totally stupid. And it took me until I was in my mid-40s to get over that. And I didn't even then. But I'm sure over it now. This is it. My life is right now. Every moment of it. And I suppose because I'm older, and I don't know how many years I've got left. You know, we're in May. May is the most amazing month in this country. It's simply staggering. And I think how many more days will I see? My mother died at 96, so I've got a chance of another 25. Yeah. That's great, but it's limited. So I'm damn well going to watch as the countryside appears around me. And I think that sort of relaxing and not comparing yourself all the time with other people who are more successful than yourself, which, by the way, never stops, whatever level of your success. I know people who are unbelievably successful. David Hare. You know, you would have thought David Hare was the most applauded, lauded, knighted writer in the world, and a very good writer, and a very good man. Feels tremendously prickly and defensive all the time. Are you saying I'm not good enough for you? And it's just how people are. It never ends, that feeling of somebody else is doing better than me, or I'm not getting the due that I want. So you have to turn yourself right around, and you have to say, God almighty, look at all the people dragging their lives out in absolute abject misery. If I'm not in the gutter, I'm winning. And then you can, then when you write, it becomes a joy, and becomes a process which is, I think, profoundly enriching. Now, I have not covered it. I'm going to stop because I'm conscious of the fact that all I'm doing is talking about myself, and what probably you want to know is much more practical stuff. So why don't I stop, and if anybody wants to ask me something, please do. Yes?
Yes. The scripts that were obviously trashed and all the following, they're stacked up there.
Mm.
Now, is there, I know there's those copyright issues about these things, and what's keeping them for 150 years.
Yes.
Is there any way you can extrapolate those stories, even those texts you might originally have, turn them around, retitle, and use or reuse any of those texts in a British context or another context, that you can at least save some of your writing?
Conceivably, if I did a good enough disguise,
yes.
They own them.
Yes,
when the studios pay,
yeah.
They don't only own them, they assert, and it'll say it on all credits, 20th Century Fox asserts the right of authorship to this work. So, and A, they own it, B, they don't want anybody else to make a success of it, because then they look stupid having done it. So essentially, the psychology is, if we're not going to make it, nobody's going to make it.
Mm.
You know, if we don't play in the game, you don't get the ball. It's what they do. So they're very, very obstructive.
Would they notice if we did the job that you suggested?
It's a good question. Probably not. If I were to, I'd be a little bit nervous of it. I mean, I wrote one of my favourite scripts is about an American general. He wasn't a general, he was a self-invented general in the Philippines in the Second World War. A sort of Lawrence of Arabia story. A man called Wendell Fertig. It's a fantastic story, a real story. Now, I would love to rescue that, but I'd have to, what would I do? I'd have to give it a different name, not do it in the Philippines. There are various ways I could use the plot. But you know what? At the end of the day, there's no shot. And unless I can literally take the exact script and have somebody else finance it. And that has happened. That particular one, 30, a guy contacted me just recently. I mean, I wrote that 20 years ago, and he said, I have a deal at Sony, which is where the script is lodged, and I'm told this is an amazing script, and I had to look at it with the possibility of resuscitating it. This was a script which, as soon as I wrote it, was immediately grabbed by Tom Cruise's producer for Tom Cruise, and for a year he was going to do it. Then he backed out. Then David Fincher and Brad Pitt took it on, and they were going to do it. And I had a meeting with all these people. Then that didn't happen. And then everybody gives up. So it is good, but this chap said to me, I can get it made because I'm inside the studio. However, I got it. And it is an expensive film, so it'll probably never happen. What I have done, I'm trying to think whether I've recycled one of my old novels, but then of course I had control of that, and published it. And it was better than original, but still not good. On the whole, I would rather just make up something else.
There is good for me to go over something which might be boring to talk about again. It might be interesting to hear about the Gladiator. You've talked about the things where you've been sacked from a project. In that, you were the guy who made it to the finishing line.
That's right.
So what were the kind of politics around doing
that? The way that happened was, I was working on a project called American Caesar for a producer called Doug Wick. And American Caesar in the end never got made. That's for Jack Nicholson. And they'd run into trouble on Gladiator. And they'd had two writers on it. The first writer had produced work. The original idea was obvious, and everybody loved it. His scripts were appalling. The main character called Narcissus in his version. And, gay Gladiator doesn't work. And so they hired another writer who was very, very good. Very good writer called John Logan. And John transformed the whole thing. However, he was working from such a low base that although what he did was a hell of a lot better, nobody realized quite that it still wasn't working. And that's very common, by the way. If you think it was that bad and now it's this, we're so happy. But actually, if you were starting here, you would say, no, it's not better. So they got to the point where they were committed to the director, committed to the star, committed to the set design, and they realized the script wasn't working. And they had a read through for the cast, and it was obvious that it was not working. So Doug, who I was working for on something else, who was the producer of Gladiator, said to me, would you take a look at it? So I took a look at it, and I said, look, it's completely obvious what the problems are here. You have a character who's just a really nasty piece of work and goes around killing everybody. I mean, who wants to see that? And he said, well, lots of people want to see that. I don't want to see that. I want to see a character who I love. Can't you, make him be something? And also, you've got all this politics, and it's completely boring. And it's all got clogged up there. So he said, well, put it down on a bit of paper and what your thoughts are. So I wrote about two pages saying, this is what you have to do. And he sent it to the studio bosses, and they said, hire this guy. So I was hired. And I was hired by the week, and they said, could you do 2 weeks' work, please? And they were 4 weeks off shooting. And they had a battle to film at the beginning, which was going to take about 3 weeks. So I had about 7 weeks before they would get into anything beyond. But as soon as I started, I realized I was going to have to make much bigger changes. And I said, look, I've got this idea. Why does this guy love everybody when his wife is killed by the bad guy? And all he wants to do is kill the bad guy, Commodus the Emperor. And it ends as a sort of act of vengeance. All right, vengeance is okay, but who does he love? And they said, I don't know, who does he love? So he said, well, he can love the Emperor's sister, who he's got a bit of a thing for, but that's all a bit kind of quirky and bent and so on. So why can't we have him be somebody who we can identify with, not as a killer, but as a kind of straight-up guy? Let's have him be a farmer. Let's have him be somebody who adores his family. Let's have him be somebody who doesn't want to fight. He doesn't want to be a soldier. He just happens to be really good at it. So how can we turn this into a proper love story? Well, we better not kill the wife. Trouble is, that's part of the plot. She gets killed. So I said, well, we're going to have an afterlife. If we have an afterlife, then it's fine. Then if we've got an afterlife, the wife's dead. He wants to meet her again in heaven. Then we've got somewhere to go that somebody other than adolescent males will be interested in. Because there are films for adolescent males which consist entirely of people killing each other. I'm not interested. Come to me for that. So they said, fine, give it an afterlife. So I said, if you're going to give it an afterlife, a lot's going to change all the way through. Even in the battle, a lot's going to change. If they're going to war, I want to know that they have a notion that when they die, there's something else. Now, these are Romans. What's the Roman afterlife? I haven't a clue what a Roman afterlife. So I went at home, and I didn't have a book on Roman afterlife on my shelves. But I did have Robert Graves' Greek Myths. So I pulled that off the shelf, and I thought, well, we'll have a Greek afterlife. And so I put in a Greek afterlife, and called it a Roman afterlife. And I wrote it into the first battle scene. They're riding along, and there's a line about, you know, if you suddenly find that, I can't remember how it goes, you know, that you're riding through green fields, don't worry, you're dead. And we will all meet again. I also said we have to start the film not with military glory, we have to start it with something completely different. Something about a guy who loves the natural world. So if you remember, I probably don't, the first shot is a hand over a wheat field.
There's
a bird singing, and then you come to Maximus and he's looking up and sees the bird. Now, what's the point of that? The point of that is it immediately establishes this is a guy who has a connection with something other than war. He walks around the corner, and there's a great big army. Suddenly, wham, we're into battle. So I did my 2 weeks, and they said, well, this has a knock-on effect, go to a bit more. Anyway, I worked on it right to the end, to all the way through, 15 weeks. And all the time, I was watching the dailies as they came back, as was obviously the director and the producer, and we were reacting to it. So I was crafting the film to what we were seeing happen. So when it became obvious that Joaquin Phoenix was amazing, we were able to build his character. So the result was I basically wrote the whole thing. And that's an unusual situation to be in. And therefore I got a credit. All three writers got credits. In the rules in American film, which are set by the Writers Guild of America, the first writer has to have a credit even if there is nothing left. He has to. And that's because they want to protect first writers, and I approve.
Good word.
Anybody who follows has to have contributed at least 33% of the movie in terms of story beats, dialogue, character creation, whatever, and you have to prove it to a panel of fellow writers. And it's quite an elaborate process. And we went through this elaborate process. I was what's called a production rewriter, which is somebody who comes on while the production is underway. Production rewriters never get credit. You know, they are fixers at the last minute. They're the guys who bang in a joke at the last minute. But I did. And I did because I did so much. And it was quite obvious. So I'm very proud of that. But it wasn't just me. It was, you know, the magic of Gladiator was a whole lot of people doing really, really good work. And none of us knew it was going to be as good as it was, to be honest. It didn't look it as we were going along. And the music, which is so stunning. The first draft of the music was hopeless. And the producer said, chuck it out, start again, which is what they do a lot. So it was a lot of fun to work on for me because I had nothing to lose. You know, this great kind of juggernaut was going over the cliff, and it wasn't my fault. And so anything I could do was better. So I was very free, and I think that freedom is very important. And a lot of writers, particularly in the film world, get frightened by frightened of failure, frightened of writing something and being told it's no good. What do you do if you're frightened? You fall back on the known. You produce genre writing. You produce something that is already there, that has succeeded. Oh, well, you know, let's have a shadowy figure appear with a hatchet, you know. And the really interesting writing is risky. And it risks people telling you that you're not good. And we're all frightened of that. So if you can somehow, I mean, I'm always telling producers, you must build a cocoon of trust around your writers. Then you will get the best work out of them. If you make them frightened all the time, you'll get the worst work out of them. And we're all like that. I mean, being criticized as a writer is terrifying because it's really you. You know, you may say, oh, I'm writing about giraffes, but really it's you. And we know that. So we're it's very, very, very hard to take criticism. It's hard to hear it and it's hard to believe it. And I think you have to, certainly as a screenwriter, you have to be very strong and very zen. And if you're zen, you say, this too shall pass. I let go of it, do what you want with it. But then they ask you to do something and you pour your heart and soul into it. And then you let go. And that process of giving all, letting go, is what you have to do all the time. It's really hard. Because that way you give your best work and you don't get destroyed. And I know an awful lot of writers who've been destroyed by the this is the film. It's very, very cruel on writers. Yeah.
Yes, thanks. Listening to what you're saying, I detect a theme, if it's not preposterous to say that, in that I was very struck by your pointing out that writers are living twice, and it could even be more than that, three or four times, because when you're involved in something, you keep noticing things that come in handy, so to speak.
Quite true.
And also, but also you've been talking about your writing novels, screenplays, so forth. It seems to me you're advocating very strongly that a writer has to have several strands going on in a life simultaneously. And does this mean working at different paces? Because when you're writing a novel, it can take all morning to get 500 words done,
yeah.
Whereas Noel Coward wrote Private Lives in a weekend, and all the obituaries of David Story pointed out how he wrote all his plays in less than a week. Do you find one of the advantages of writing for the stage or Hollywood or whatever is its swift work?
Mm-hmm.
That could
right. Yes. On the question of multiple genres, or indeed multiple projects. That's how I work. It's not how everybody works. And it's a matter of temperament. I found it immensely valuable to have more than one project on at once. It's a sort of psychological life raft policy. So that as one boat sinks, you think, oh, I jump onto this one. And they do sink. So if I was just doing one project and I was waiting for the phone call on it, I would cut my throat. Whereas as it is, the minute I finish something and deliver it, as far as I'm concerned, it has vanished, and I'm on to something else. So it's been necessary for me. It's been necessary financially as well, because a lot of the stuff I do I don't get paid for. In terms of, I don't know what to say about the speed thing. You see a film script, yes, it's fast, but you do a million drafts. So I'm actually on a script. I mean, this one that's coming out in October, I started writing 9 years ago, and they only shot it last year, and I've probably done 14 drafts of it. So it has actually taken up a lot of time. But at any one moment, it's quick.
Mm.
Whereas the novel's the exact opposite. And the way I do it, and I do very strongly appreciate the change of pace. This morning I've been working on my next novel. So I've been sitting, going very slowly. I've got a huge structure in my mind and on paper. And I write maybe 3 pages, if I'm lucky. And then suddenly, I mean, tomorrow I've got to be pulled off to do other things. And I'm doing something very fast, because particularly when a film's going into production, they want work very, very fast. And I think I do enjoy that change of pace. I think there's something, some people love it, but the thing a bit about being locked in a world of one project all by yourself for long periods of time, I find debilitating. I find it sort of drains my energy. Whereas it re-energizes me to come out and do something else, and then I go back in. And quite often, it's like any process of writing. When you, I don't know if, the way I work is I write in the morning. So I write in the morning, and what I write looks good. If I'm stupid and reread it in the evening, it doesn't look good. And I feel terrible. And I just think, why did I do that? So I don't anymore. I just don't do that. I work in the morning, because I happen to be fresh in the morning. If you're fresh, as many people are at night, then do it at night. And in the morning, I feel excited and optimistic, and it's looking good. And then when I return to it next morning, it's as if I've lived a lifetime, and I've got more to give to it. And it's the same when I switch projects. I switch projects. I'm writing a film about Tutankhamun, and you know I'm in 1920s Egypt, and I'm writing a film about Putin's Russia, and I'm in Putin's Russia.
Mm.
These projects are more present. And then I'm on my novel, which is set in 1862 in Sussex, and it sort of somehow stimulates me. But not everybody works that way, and I think probably I'm not a great writer, and great writers, I think, I read about these people who spend 10 years on a book. My God, that's incredible, 10 years, how do they do that? And sometimes the books are Donna Tartt, who I like very much, so spends 10 years on a book. Well, she went. I'm not of that caliber. Yes?
I was saying, I just had a book published, I spent 7 years on it.
You just had a book published?
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Has it just come out?
Yes, came out, it was launched last week.
Oh, wow!
Yeah, so.
Exciting! How's it going?
Very well, BBC, they have a radio pickstar, and they
BBC Radio picked up for the book of the week?
No, it's BBC Radio, sorry, Sussex.
Okay, yeah.
In the Second World War memoir, the guy whose memoirs is. And then the British Forces Broadcasting Service are filming us tomorrow.
Wonderful.
I'm going to press, that's good. And I wrote this, and I wanted to convey into a film because it was once written with a view to be made for filming. But if it is made into a film, I want it to be faithful to the book because having lived with these men.
These are real men.
These are real men. So the whole story is written. You've got the main character, and you've got the emotional arch all the way through. And then I've also got other field ambulances coming in as well. So
yeah.
These are all real men.
Yeah.
If it's made into a film, I would want the filmmakers to make a faithful representation of the book.
Yeah.
And it's how much clout a writer has to sort of go in and say, this is incredible, this is completely out of keeping with the British War on the Medical Corps.
I understand. It's all about the deal that you do. The normal answer would be zero clout. Once you've sold your book, it's gone. And it will be completely screwed around, and you will be completely unable to do anything whatsoever. That would be the normal situation. And most people are so happy to sell a book and to come out in any form at all that they gladly sign that. You don't have to. You can say, I must have right of control over the script. Now, the only problem with that is they'll be frightened that you exercising your right of control will stop them making the maximum value out of the story. So when they decide to invent a girlfriend who dies in an awful accident, you see, but that didn't happen. And I don't want it to happen, and it distorts that character. They say, well, but it helps the story. So there's a collision. And if you do say, it must be as I write it, they will probably not buy the book, I would say. Not because they want to do something terrible, but because they'd be frightened that you would stop them from making it into what they would see as its best version. So it's a very difficult situation. The more humble the filmmaking process, the more chance you've got to control it. The grander, the less. In any Hollywood studio, dream on, you're dark. That applies, by the way, to people who write novels, which are bored. They feel completely free. I mean, the people send me novels, studios send me novels, saying, will you do an adaptation of this, which I don't usually do. And I say, but I don't like the story. They say, change the story. So it is, looking at it from the point of view of the filmmakers, making films is expensive. They've got to get a lot of people into the cinema to get their money back. It's not your money, it's their money. So, if they think that it'll be a better story if the main character is blown up towards the end, but actually he wasn't, they don't want to do that. So you do have a problem. I think your best bet, it depends partly on how inherently dramatic the main story is. If it is inherently dramatic, they will stick with that, actually, because it's in their interest to do that. If it isn't, they'll build it up in some way or other. However, you can make any conditions you want. You absolutely can. Until you sell it, it's yours. But I say that, but if this is in the public domain, if they love the story, they can tell you bye-bye and they can go off and make a film.
Mm-hmm.
But it may not be in the public domain, I don't know.
It's all on water,
who owns the war diaries? Who owns the copyright?
So
they can
go to National Archives,
okay,
pick out all the references in the book, and
ban
the book.
They could, but to be honest, they won't. People don't do that. I mean, everybody's terrified of having their story stolen. Unless it's, I suppose, maybe it happens once, but I've never heard of it. You've done the work, they're grateful. So I think what I would say is, don't rely on a contractual clause, do it through the relationship. So if a film company is interested, then talk to them and say, how do you see the story? And if, as they talk about it, it's quite clear they want to tell the same story as you, then you have to trust. You say, fine. They won't like signing a clause that gives you the right to stop them doing what they want to do, because they'll give it to a screenwriter. If the screenwriter is told, I'm afraid you've got to stick exactly with what the original author wrote, the screenwriter may get a bit shirty. So, but with a little bit of communication and honesty and so forth, it ought to work out, actually, because on the whole, if they're buying that for a film, it's because they like what you've done. So I think I would say go into it with your eyes open, but don't be too worried.
J.K. Rowling, of course, is the exception to
this. Yes, good.
The bit you mean in terms of control?
In terms of control.
Yeah,
yes.
Goodness gracious,
yes.
Look at the power she's got.
My question is, if you are directing your own script,
yeah.
What is the director's relationship to the writer?
When I'm directing the script or not?
As you're putting across the field and the director.
Well,
I've directed plays that I've written, and when
yes.
you're directing and you see something that's not in play, what's the relationship with yourself?
Right?
Oh, yeah.
So I've done it once, and well, as you say, that's what you have to do, as it rehearses, as it, you rework it. And of course it's wonderful if you're the writer as well, because if you're not, I mean, I've been a writer on scenes where, you know, they seem to be this, I come in and fix it, as best I can. But in this occasion, I can literally fix it as we go along. And or I might say to the actors, I mean, what I did last time, I've done this once. We did a lot of read-through, a lot of rehearsal, not a lot of December. And it's pretty clear when things are working and when they're not. But the other thing about film, as opposed to plays, with a play, when you put on a play, the whole thing runs, and you think, oh shit, it's not working. With a film, because you've written lots of little bits, you don't know it's not working if you've got it in the cutting room. And then you're really up the pole. But of course, you're up the pole, but you've got lots of tricks to play to make it work. You chuck stuff out, turn it around, and so on, which you can't do in a play because it's there, it's on the stage. So I think they're very different animals. I've never directed a play, so I don't know. I've been directed, I had a very, very fine director called Peter Wood, who's now dead, who directed my second play. And my second play was a disaster. It's called Man with a Heart. And West End play, and it opened and closed in 3 weeks, and that was very, very brutal. But the rehearsal period with Peter Wood was extraordinary, because he'd all done all the Stoppard's plays, and he sort of wanted me to do a Stoppard play, and he kept on pushing, and I found this very exciting, so I kept on changing and changing and changing, but in the end it turned into a play that sort of wasn't mine and wasn't Stoppard's, obviously, and it didn't work. So I learned a lesson from that. It was a bit late.
So I was just going to make a brief addendum to that point. It was about the fact that you were going to bring this point up. It's about J.K. Rowling. What happened was that people like Cullen were selling usual deals to people like Hal Collins or whatever, and the film deal was what you sign in it.
Yeah.
Bloomsbury was a small publisher, and they didn't even have a clause like that. They were saying don't give up the day jobs, you're well known. And that is why people had to come to her individually. Actually approach about the films. It wasn't a contract saying I want it made my way.
Well,
anything at all.
Well, hang on.
No, sure.
All of my print works, I withhold the film rights.
Yeah.
The publisher doesn't withhold the film rights. I have. But that doesn't mean that if somebody comes to me and says I want to make the film, that they're going to say to me, you can have control.
Yeah.
I could only do that if I was J.K. Rowling. You have to have such power that you could do that, because they don't want it. They really, really don't want to do that.
No.
So, and I can't think of anybody other than her who's ever had that power.
Just that I've heard of the Bloomsbury contract, they just didn't even think of that, which is why.
Well, that may be so, but in all book contracts, sometimes they'll say to you, "We will pay you in advance, but we want everything: world rights, film rights, stage rights, everything." And it's up to you to say yes or no to that. In all of my contracts, I retain all the film rights. Much good as it doesn't have rights. Nobody's ever made any film out of anything I've ever written, as a book. Have anybody else?
Yes. Yeah, this is more of like a, this is going to be pure anecdotal for your purposes. A lot of writers, they suffer from writer's block.
Yes.
Apparently Alex Garland doesn't, which I think is mental. He's 7 years, he goes, I never get writer's block. And I heard Aaron... I heard Aaron Sorkin say once, writer's block, he said, occurs when I don't know what the scene is about. And I'm just writing endless dialogue, and it doesn't make any sense, and it has no relevance in the story. I suppose my question is, when you're writing something, A, do you get writer's block? I mean, I know the answer's probably going to be yes, but when you've solved it, do you ever solve it when you're sitting at your desk and writing, or does it occur to you when you've taken a walk, sat down having a drink, you suddenly go, shit, and then you've realised, I need to go home and write?
I think that's slightly misunderstanding what writer's block is. Yes, I do get it. I think writer's block is not being able to solve a writer's block problem. It's a collapse of confidence.
Right.
And it's that point when, I mean, we all of us have to get into a bit of a sort of euphoric state to believe that what we're writing is any good. And it's that moment when the little voice in your head says, but this is crap. And it is paralyzing. And we all of us live with two voices. One voice says, they haven't discovered it yet, but you're a genius. And this voice says, you're shit.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the critical voice. This is the creative voice, and this is the critical voice. And when I'm writing, sometimes I suddenly get a complete doubt in the whole project. And this is impossible to continue. You know, willpower won't keep you going. If you suddenly think, why am I even doing this? It's no good. But I have a trick, which works. So I say to myself, okay, I've suddenly lost faith in everything I'm doing. But here I am sitting at my desk. So why don't I have a plan of what's supposed to happen next. So what I'm going to do is, instead of writing the next scene or the next chapter, I'm going to write fairly detailed notes about it. And these notes are to assist me should I regain confidence. But they're not the real thing. So critical voice, you don't need to watch. This isn't writing, this is just notes. I'm just jotting a thing down. You're literally writing with dashes, and it's not proper sentences or anything.
Yes, indeed.
And I swear to you, do that for 5 minutes, and you'll start writing. It's a sort of trick to shut up your critical voice. Now, it doesn't always work, but that's what I do. What I don't do is give up. But that's just me. I mean, because I've been at it such a long time and had such a long period of getting nowhere, I've developed a very strong discipline. And the discipline says, you push on. Whatever you do, you push on. Even if you're writing notes or looking back and rewriting, you don't stop. I only write in the mornings. I don't write after lunch. So that morning time, you keep going. I don't allow myself the luxury of saying, oh, I think I won't. And I think that trick of saying, it's not like this, it's not good, but it'll be a placeholder. And then when my genius returns, I'll rewrite that. is quite helpful. And it's quite surprising how quickly you can then find you've overtaken your block.
So I think I heard Stephen Knight say something similar. I think Stephen Knight said
something.
Does he? He goes, I'm not really doing this today.
That's right.
It's just practicing.
That's right.
Around.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's just mugging around.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. I mean, Alex Garland, you all, I'm sure, seen Ex Machina. It's the most brilliant film. He directed that himself. So I hats off to him, without a doubt. And you know, in a way, writer's block is all about taking yourself too seriously. And if you can kind of manage to be a bit, laugh at yourself a bit, then it's like, what do you expect? I'm not brilliant. I'm doing my best. Give me a break. I'm getting over it, you know. And then you can go on. Anybody else?
I was going to say, it sounds like actually screenwriting in particular, where you're writing stuff that's not the final thing at all. You're writing something that's going to have to be adapted and produced. You have to just generally accept there's going to be a large amount of imperfection. You just have to accept imperfection. Whereas I guess with theatre and maybe novels, it's less like that. Maybe it's more
that's
something you can aspire for something to be as perfect as you want it to be. You're not handing it over to others to then play with. And try
that
and
is
play.
Absolutely true. And with the novel writing, what you tell yourself is, I'm going to do another draft, which you do. So you do your own rewriting process.
Right.
And often, probably not enough. Probably you don't get enough critical input. Which is why a lot of novels are so badly done, really, I mean, but you're right with screenwriting. I always say to screenwriters, do your drafts fast and dirty. Don't hover over it and hug it, because it's going to get kicked around. Knock something out quick, let your collaborators give their input, do it again, do it again, do it again. With plays, stage plays is an interesting one. I've done 5 stage plays, and in my experience, which I love, the rehearsal period is a rewriting period, to be honest. So obviously I've done my own rewriting to get it to the point where I can deliver it. When a director comes on board, quite often the director will have a lot of ideas. Then when you get it on the floor, the actors have a lot of ideas. And then you've got to be able and willing to roll with that, not to allow it to disintegrate the play, which it can do. I mean, I love theatre because, of course, as a writer, you are the king. Whereas in film, you are not.
Is that only why you thought was then in your situation as well, where you have ended up writing something you love, and if you were to try and have some influence, not the kind of influence that J.K. Rowling had, but if you want to just have some, does it help
you? You do a film.
Obviously, they want it to be successful. They're anxious that your influence will impede it being successful.
Yes.
Could it mitigate to try and convince them that you also know about film and adaptation, and maybe also that you would be quite happy for it to make a lot of money? Is there a way to mitigate that they can trust that you have that judgment rather than that
very
you're just
much
being
so. Very, very much so. Precious. I mean, that's exactly right. I mean, I'm very unprecious. I mean, I want what they want. I want a successful film. And the problem happens when you disagree about what will create that success. It's not like I'm saying my art is being messed with by commercial people.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like that at all.
Right.
It's like, how is this going to be at its most powerful? And people disagree on that. And I mean, I've made big mistakes in the past. I mean, I wrote a film called Nell a long time ago with Jodie Foster, Liam Neeson, and Ashley Richardson. And that film is about a wild child who's sort of discovered in the woods, and she has no language or anything. And the basic trajectory was the people who discovered her realized that she has a source of wisdom that they lack, and her way of directly addressing what's actually happening emotionally to them heals a broken marriage between them, Natasha Richards and the Neeson characters. And they begin to realize she's a remarkable person. So the question is, how to end it? What do we do with this creature played by Jodie Foster? And I made a big mistake. I wrote a happy ending that she ends up as a sort of guru in a context around her. And I did that because I thought that was right to give it the greatest satisfaction. Nobody made it good. Only good. And I was wrong. What I should have done is had an ending where we realize her incredible gifts, and then along come the social services and drag her away to an institution. And in other words, a tragedy. Because that's what would have happened. And it just didn't ring true. And that was my fault. And nobody made me do it. Perhaps if I'd offered the tragic ending, it would have stopped me, but I didn't even offer it. Anybody else?
You mentioned that Shadowlands was unchanged, the script.
The film script,
yes.
Yeah.
So would you consider that to be high watermark in terms of writing for the screen?
Yeah, totally. Totally. I mean, I've never ever had anything that's been where I've had a director who gets it.